I was in the service, spent 4 years Navy. I boarded a destroyer, 2 years at sea. We pulled into Yokosuka, which is the naval base there, and then I took a train up to Tokyo. I wanted to see the city. I wanted to see all the excitement of the city. And for some reason, this guy I was with, let's go to the Tokyo Museum. He was interested in art too. Yeah. And we went to the Tokyo Museum. There was a huge retrospective of Impressionist paintings that had been sent over from the Louvre. That was going to be there for several months. So we walk in, and I tell you, Scott, my mind was just totally blown. I saw all those paintings, Van Gogh, Monet, Degas, and the color and the images. And I don't know, I tell people something just snapped in my brain.
So before that, nothing?
Nothing. Really? I never had an art class. I never did drawings when I was a kid. We never had any art in our home. So I saw that show and it just turned me around. And I started working aboard the ship. I started making little drawings. And of course, you're not supposed to make a little drawings aboard a destroyer that goes up into the North Pacific. So I had to hide them. I had to hide them in my locker. So the officers wouldn't see them. So it was kind of clandestine hidden art. But I took them with me when I was discharged and went home.
What were you drawing on the ship?
I was drawing just doodles, if I can remember. Figures, heads, portraits. Portraits of geisha girls, images I would find in magazines, like a guy's head.
Yes.
I just jumped into it.
Yeah.
I didn't really know that much about art. I've never done it before. It was all very raw. It was very crude. It was very beginning. I really didn't give a shit. I just was having so much fun doing it.
What year was that?
I got out in 1962. I was discharged and I went to Baylor for a semester. I took a summer class. I didn't really get going until I got to the Art Institute in San Francisco.
Right. That was later in
64. Just, I'm so happy I went there at that time. I'm so glad that I went there. I had support at this junior college. Had a instructor I was working with, he was very encouraging. He kept saying, you draw just like Richard Diebenkorn. You draw just like Richard. Mm-hmm. I didn't know who the hell Richard Diebenkorn was. He says, I'm going to make a call and see if I can get you an interview there. So he did. I went up, I did the interview, I was accepted. I went that fall to the Art Institute. It was just fantastic. It was just so like anything I've ever experienced before. I was painting one day in the painting studio, but I was painting and it was crowded. And I was working on this painting and there was a guy right behind me working and I had squeezed out some cadmium yellow. And I was getting ready to put it on the painting and I looked down and it's gone. The paint is not there anymore. So I turned around and I said, hey man, did you take my paint? Did you take my cadmium yellow? He said, yeah man, I took your cadmium yellow. I needed it and I couldn't afford it. And I said, what the fuck are you doing, man? That was my paint. He said, be cool, man. Just be cool. I got some, I got a little weed here. We can smoke, we can chill out. I said, fuck you, man. I said, I gotta finish this painting. I got work to do. You want to smoke? Go ahead. So he's back there smoking a doobie, and I was painting with that cadmium yellow, you know? What the fuck? What the hell? Of course, you're going to edit this.
Well, no, I like all of that.
You know, and I told you that before, that story?
No.
Oh, that's classic. That is classic.
Well, you were there in, I mean, just the height of craziness.
Yes.
In San Francisco.
Yes. Crazy students. The instructors were absolutely fantastic. Studied with the best. Of course, Richard Diebenkorn was there. I took a class with him. And he would come around and talk about my paintings. I didn't understand one thing he was telling me. He was speaking like he could have been speaking French. I did not understand what he was telling me about. Don't overwork the canvas. Leave it just like where it's at. Got to Peoria in 1969. We were living in a little house, rental house. And I worked in the basement. I set up a studio in the basement. And I made a large painting, of course, that I finally had to cut in half to get it out of the basement, which those things didn't bother me in those days. It was a huge still life. It had, animals and fruit and fish, and a big smoking pipes for hashish. Had a kind of an X pattern in it. And I worked in there, and then I got a studio downtown. I went in with some of my fellow colleagues. We went upstairs. It was a third floor studio, big, 17,000 square feet. Three of us split it up, and I worked up there. And I immediately started a painting 40 feet long. I wanted to do a billboard size painting, and I had the opportunity to do it, and I did it. And it was crazy. It was wild. It was wonderful.
What happened to some of these large pieces from way back?
They burned up in a fire.
I forgot about that.
Remember the fire? Merkel Building went up in flames.
Mm-hmm.
Lost just about everything. Had to start over again. That was heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Well, we all did. The remaining three, four people that were up there, we lost it all. So, what do? You start again. Crazy art stories or galleries, collectors. Oh my. I probably need to get into New York for a few days and just go through and see what they're doing. Sometimes I talk to them, sometimes they do not want to talk to you. We're not talking to you today. Okay, then you go to the next one. And if that doesn't work, you go to the next one. I did that a lot when I first started showing my work in Chicago. I would take the work in. I was with, cannot remember her name, damn it. So she said, bring the work in, Ken. So I rented a station wagon. I had some fairly larger pieces. Oh my God, man, this was when I first got up there. 70s, big time for Chicago. And I rented a station wagon. I put my stuff in there. And I went to her gallery, and I was drinking Maalox like mad to settle my stomach. I was so nervous. I walked in there with a Maalox mustache, I'm sure. She said, get those paintings out, get that plastic off. I can't see them with the plastic on it. Get them over here, put them over here where I can see them. So I got everything set up, and she, Joy Harwick was her name, Joy Harwick Gallery. Tough little Jewish woman. So I had my stuff set up, and she's walking, and she's looking, and she's walking, and she's looking, and she's not saying anything. So she sits down at her desk. She has a pencil, and she's beating the desk with a pencil. And she keeps saying, "I just don't know. I just don't know." I said, "What is it you don't know, Joy? Tell me what you're thinking about." "I don't know to take a chance with these. I don't know what they'll do." "Okay," I said, "give me the name of somebody here in the city I can take these over to and show them this afternoon before I have to go back home." So there's this dead silence, and she says, "Okay, Ken, leave me that one, and that one." That's the gallery world, a little bit of it. I tried other galleries. I got into some of them. I was invited to several really important shows there. Chicago was very good for a while. I got in with Carrie Segrist, and we damn near sold out the show. She was very excited about my work, and she had a lot of buyers. We sold that work that night. I had a buyer that came up, and he started buying from the slides. They sold everything out, so they're looking at the slides, and this guy says, "I want to buy this painting." And I said, "Where is it?" I said, "It's not here." He said, "Where is it?" And I said, "It's in Peoria in my studio." He said, "Well, let's just get in the car and go down there and get it." I said, "Okay, you ready? How are you going to get it in your car? You know, it's 6 by 6 feet. "Well, we'll have it shipped. That's what we'll do. I'm buying the painting, and we're going to arrange for you to ship it to me." Goddamn, the guy bought the painting right there. Couldn't believe it. Just crazy.
So what are you working on?
Working on this bird, and I'm adding a jazz guy. I've added a jazz guy in the corner, and I'm trying to add some fish in here. I don't know if it's gonna make it or not. I have changed this thing about 70 times.
Well, you do that a lot with your work, don't you? Go through a lot of changes.
Yeah, I keep changing it. I'm not afraid to go back in and change it. I'll do anything to it. Like, I tried this pink paper today. Kept it real flat. Everything in here is flat, and I'm going to add some blue. There's going to be a blue, bright blue shirt, whatever happened to that, which will come in here. That'll really pick that up.
Yeah.
Here we go. Here's my blue. Cutting out my blue. Cutting out a piece of blue. And this will, this blue is really going to brighten things, which is going to be cool against that pink. Anytime you get blue and pink together, you're going to have a certain kind of tension. How's the tension?